This is the story of all the big institutions here. They want to get grant from the West, which means you have to dance to their tune, and he gets a grant and does the same thing that they say and publish it, and they praise him and they get something out of it, and then his CV grows and he becomes a big man. And if he dances to their tune more and more, they will take him to the World Bank or to the WHO for one stint, and he gets pension in dollars afterwards. This is what's called Indian science today. That is not science. And Manish, how did he get this? It's a fascinating idea. I love that sentence. What we think is science. Science simply is trying to understand nature. Science is curiosity. Remember that? A child is a scientist, brilliant scientist. You give the child a toy, for 2 days the child looks at the toy very carefully, which is called observation, one of the very important requisites of a scientist. Keeps it there in the place. Father and mother are happy, my child has done it. Second day, it licks it to see if it has got any taste. Another sense observation. Third day, it smells it. And when the fourth day nothing happens, it breaks it. Then the father and the mother are terribly upset. If your child has not broken a toy, that child is a dull child. If your child has broken not one toy but many toys, that child is likely to get a Nobel Prize. Because today science's root has changed. In the olden days, the Greek root of science was cier, which means knowledge. But today, the Oxford English Dictionary and the Webster's Dictionary have accepted Sanskrit as the root of Indo-European languages. So science has got a Sanskrit root called ski. Ski means cut into. So when you cut into things and go in and see how nature works, that's called science. I'll tell you one example which affects all of you. Today, anybody you say, oh, his creatinine is high. He must be having dialysis soon and then a kidney transplant. And you run around and big hospital, tons of money. The dialysis is the biggest money spinner in America. There are doctors running only dialysis units, nothing else. He has 10 beds, 9 to 5 job. Fellow comes, lies down there, he is dialyzed, evening he goes back, $5,000 in. What science we don't know is, I'll tell you something, there is a black bear in San Francisco, Yosemite side, on the hills. This bear sleeps sometimes for 3 to 6 months. How many months? 3 to 6 months it sleeps. It doesn't take a drop of water, it doesn't take a grain of food, it doesn't move a muscle, it doesn't do at all, and it sleep, fast asleep. Now, according to our science of medicine, if you don't eat, if you don't drink water, that's why people are worried when Anna says, I'm going on Anshan, people get jitters, because he'll die, ketosis and blah, blah. No ketosis for that bear. 3 months it sleeps, you wake it up, it is so ferocious, it can kill you. Its muscles are stronger than when it went to sleep. Its bones are stronger than when it went to sleep. His creatinine is lower than when it went to sleep. And its all parameters of the body are fine. Now, one of my old students who is working in Harvard, he applied for a research grant to find out how does the physiology of the bear differ from the physiology of man. He didn't get the grant. Do you know why? If he finds out, then our whole business of dialysis and transplant, everything will go. Supposing he finds out how to keep yourself fit when you don't take food, when you don't take anything. I have seen a Swamiji in Karthikeyan's house. He doesn't take food at all. No water, nothing. He has been a policeman. He has been watching him. Days on end, he simply stands in the morning in front of the sun. And he keeps on looking at the sun, absorbing the energy from the sun. And he has taken him to Mansarovar. This man had 5 layers of clothes, and that man had only one kachcha and nothing here, and he was sleeping on the ice on Mansarovar with his shawl. Can you believe that? He has got the video. Sir, ninge kaamikana inda pasangalukella illana namba matanga. This man, our rishis were there doing tapas. For months together, their creatinine didn't go up. They had so much of strength. Do you know how it happens? When you say, What you hear here is sound, but what goes inside becomes ultrasound, because the vibration of the vocal cords, the ultrasound goes in. Ultrasound is very powerful energy. When it goes inside the lung, there are these bubbles of water in the lung. These bubbles coalesce. It's called sonoluminescence. They coalesce because of this energy. So when they coalesce, they release so much of energy that this man gets enough energy for the next 1 month. Just see. Obama got converted because for 10 days, our prime minister lived only on hot water and addressed 60 meetings. Obama said, this man is not man, he's God. You know something? Because he does 1.5 hours of pranayama in the morning. He sleeps for only 3 hours. This only sannyasis could do. So our science of the West is not science. It's a golem. G-O-L-E-M. Mind you, this book is written by two professors of physics in New York. Harry Collins and Trevor Pinch. Harry Collins, H-A-R-R-Y. C-O-L-L-I-N-S. Trevor, T-R-E-V-O-R, Pinch, P-I-N-C-H. I have got that book now in Flipkart.com, Indian edition, for 75 rupees. Please buy it and read it. Then you know, you'll get at least head shrunk. You will get a new idea of science. If you want to read a bigger book, some research scholars may be there. I'll give you a book called Against Method. The book's name is Against Method. This girl is very good. She's writing everything. Against Method is a book which will tell you the whole fraud of Western science on the colonies. This is written by a professor of science philosophy in the London School of Economics, a very famous man, and he was a physicist himself before he became the professor of science philosophy. His name is Paul, P-A-U-L, Feyerabend, F-E-Y-R-A-B-U-N-D, Feyerabend. Paul's book is so good. Better than all that, if you still want to do PhD research on science, there's a book called A New Paradigm. The New Paradigm. Good girl. Yen class, Amma? What class are you in? You finished all the class. You are a housemaker. Neurologist. Yoga. Okay. The New Paradigm. This book will give you step by step from the Big Bang to quantum physics, how fallacious science of the West is. Written by whom? Distinguished professor of chemistry in the A&M University, who found out cold fusion. Instead of fission, he went for fusion. He has now devised a small little nuclear energy box which you can keep in your house and get enough electricity without spending any penny. You convert water into deuterium and get enough energy. His name is John Bockris, B-O-C-K-R-I-S. John Bockris's book, The New Paradigm, is a fascinating book, but it's a thick book. So it will take a lot of time to... See, I'll tell you one fraud that you are all being taken for a ride. Have you heard of AIDS? You heard of AIDS? Everybody has heard of AIDS because you're worried. Oh, AIDS coming to eat us up. Have you heard of NIDS? Anybody heard of NIDS? Ah, good girl. Anyway, for 30 million people of AIDS in the world, there are about 300 million people suffering from NIDS and dying like flies every day. Nobody knows and nobody bothers because there's no money in it. All poor people die. When poor people die, nothing happens. Now AIDS, because a white man died in 1981 in San Francisco General Hospital and the same next week in Paris in National Hospital, the whole world woke up and said, oh, AIDS. What is AIDS? We must find a cause. Scientists came up with a cause, a virus. What virus? It was, of course, HTLV virus, now converted into HIV virus. Our government spends 8 crores of rupees on AIDS research. This is a nice book. Inventing the AIDS virus. What is the book's name? What is the book's name, ma? This girl? Inventing the AIDS virus. You know who wrote it? the biggest virologist in the world who got the Genius of the Century Award. He's a fascinating man. He teaches virology in Berkeley. He has a colleague who teaches chemistry in Berkeley, but he is the father of the PCR test which identifies viruses. You know PCR test? Oh, his name is Carrie Mullis. Carrie Mullis writes the foreword for this book, this thick book, Inventing the AIDS Virus. Who writes the foreword? Carrie Mullis. And who has written the book? Duesberg. D-U-E-S-B-E-R-G. Peter Duesberg. And I won't tell you about the book, but I'll tell you four sentences in the book. Carrie Mullis writes the foreword. In the foreword he says, Peter and I don't know what causes AIDS. Peter has some hypothesis, I have some hypothesis, both may be wrong. But Peter and I know one thing for certain, which nobody can dispute because Peter is the best brain in virology. I'm the father of the virology detecting test for which I got the Nobel Prize. Peter and I do not think HIV virus causes AIDS. Full stop, unquote. Are you still in your chair or fallen down? You can't fight it. I wrote an article in the British Medical Journal and told them, why do you still carry this myth? The editor wrote to me, Professor Hegde, you know, this is, you know, some dispute between the laboratory and clinical practice. I said, it's not a laboratory and clinical practice. It's a question of people's lives. And why do you do this? And she tells me, look, you know, we can't go against the flow. I said, then why do you say you are a science journal? Publish at least mine as a letter. She published mine as a letter to the editor. I said, HIV virus doesn't cause AIDS. You don't believe that, right? So now you know how big a fraud we are in. Have you understood that?